Okay, so I like to continue on this nice session on generating random numbers with other distributions. So we are here in this session, yeah, and we had the motivation, nice motivation. Why are we actually interested in this? And we had the method of the inversion of the distribution function. Yeah, so that was here. If you have a uniform distributed random variable u and you have a distribution function f, if you apply f inverse to u, then the result x is f distributed. So that means here, if I take a uniform distributed sequence of random numbers ui, I just apply f inverse and I get my xi out of it. We also had this small warning that we should maybe check the boundary points. What happens to 0, 1 if we apply the inverse? And well, a prominent example is the normal distributed random variable. Yeah? So I need that for a Bachelier model, for a Black-Scholes model. I need that very often. So we know that we have an analytic formula for the density. So this here is the density phi. But actually, we do not have an analytic formula for the distribution function f. And of course, we also do not have an analytic formula for f inverse. But there are algorithms to approximate this function. And for example, here, this guy, this paper here, Vitura, is an approximation which is actually based on a rational function. So the ratio of two polynomials, a piecewise rational functions. So there are some if statements, if something is smaller or whatever, then a certain bound. And then you just have a rational function with some coefficients. And this approximations is correct up to an error of 10 to the minus 16. So it's actually correct up to machine precision. And that would be sufficient for us. So I have an implementation of the inverse. Yeah? And the implementation cannot be distinguished from the true solution with respect to my machine precision. So let's start a small coding session and explore a little bit this method. So I create a new class. Let's have a main method. I write everything in my main method here. Yeah, it's just a demo. So let's call this normal. So I like to explore a little bit the normal distribution, ICDF experiments. And the first thing is I would like to look how this looks like. Okay, so let's call this test normal ICDF with Java random. Okay, so I just used the standard Java random number generator. Okay, so to generate a normal distributed sequence. So let's define this. So Java util random. Maybe I have some seed here so that I always get the same sequence. And let's maybe just first print the first 20 numbers. So maybe just print the first 20 numbers. So I generate a uniform and then I generate a normal one. So now I need this inverse of the distribution function. Yeah, and for that, I need some implementation. There are implementations on the internet. So let's just take, for example, the one from Apache Common Math Library. There is a normal distribution inside this. So I have to instantiate an object of this type here. And then you can ask this object here. So maybe I need a different name here. This is the value, yeah, and this is the value. I have here cumulative probability function, and I also have an inverse cumulative probability function of this uniform value. And then I can print the result. So let's have a look how this looks like. Okay, and you see I get random numbers, also negative ones. They are not between 0 and 1. Yeah, so maybe this could be a normal distribution. So actually, I don't know, is this a normal distribution? Maybe I would like to plot this. So let's create a list of numbers so I can put this into my plotting tool. So this is the uniform. And now let's take plural values. So it's a collection of values. Okay, so let's import this list. And also the normal ones. Okay, and then instead of printing it, I will just put it into this list. So a uniform value is put it into the list of uniform values, and the corresponding normal value is added to the list of normal values. Okay, and maybe I use a few more samples. Let's take 10,000. So I lose 10,000 samples. So now I have these guys, and in my plotting toolbox, actually I can plot a histogram. So I now create some discretization of my line, some bins, and then I just count how many values do I have inside. Yeah, and then I just plot how many values do I have inside, so I can plot a histogram. So here in this plots library, there is a create histogram here with a list of doubles. So that will just count how many numbers are in this list. So let's take first the uniform ones, and then you specify here the number of discretization bins, yeah, so number of points, and the standard deviation of the area where you would like to count the number of points. So these are just parameters for this plotting library, and then you can show the plot. Let's first show the uniform ones. How does this look like? Okay, so that looks a little bit ugly here. Yeah? So maybe I should use a little bit more points. So let's take 100,000 and maybe also add some kind of title. So this here is set title. So this is uniform from Java util random. Yeah, so this is a linear concurrential generator. Yeah, just a very simple generator. And let's plot this. Okay, that looks quite okay. The histogram has a small disturbing thing. Well, you see here that the values are here at 0.025 and not at 1. Yeah, that's just because here I use an interval of length of 4. So he's just counting the number of points. I should normalize this by the length of the interval. So there is an alternative function density that just does the same, but normalizes with the number of points, with the size of the interval. And you see then you get here something which looks like a density. Yeah. So it's a density of a uniform distributed random variable. And you see that we have here some wiggling, yeah, because it's a pseudo-random. Sometimes there are spaces where we have fewer points. Sometimes there are spaces where we have many points. So this is about the discrepancy. Yeah. So that's how the uniform looks like. Let's create now the same plot with the normal values. So I exchange here the list and I say here normal via ICDF from Java util render. And let's have a look how this looks like. Okay, so that looks quite nice, right? So this is what we get for the histogram, or here for the density, if we perform this inversion of the distribution function. Yeah, of course, the inversion of the distribution function, if you remember the distribution function, many points will lie here around zero. Yeah. So, and fewer points will be stretched to the outside. So we get clearly something which looks like the density of the normal distribution. Maybe we just compare it. Let's have a look here. Wikipedia, normal distribution. They have a nice plot here. Let's look at this plot. So this is mean zero, standard deviation one. Yeah, so it is the inverse of the cumulative distribution function of the standard normal. So I would expect the red curve. Yeah? So I would expect here this red curve, and you see, yeah, it looks very similar. It goes here up to 0.4. The same here in my picture, it goes here up to 0.4. And it is a bit rough, right? It's a bit rough. If I add more points, I can improve it. Okay, so now I have used more sample points, 10 times the number of sample points, and it becomes smoother, yeah, so more straight, more uniform, and here it becomes smoother. Well, you get a better approximation. Let's go back to the rough one, yes, and just that you see that I'm doing the rough one, I just run it again. Okay, that's the rough one. And let's do the same now with a quasi random number sequence. So I had here on the slide the remark that you can also use this for a quasi Monte Carlo method for just a sequence of numbers from 0 to 1 with low discrepancy. And you should also get a very nice approximation of this distribution. So just use a low discrepancy sequence. We know the low discrepancy sequence, the van der Korpus sequence or Horton sequence. So just do the same. So I now do test normal ICDF with van der Korpus sequence. I implement that. Well, I just copy the whole code which we did here. And I just exchange the random number generator. So I can remove here the Java util random. So this means I have to replace here this line with something else. And we replace this line with the van der Korpus sequence from our session. There was get van der Korpus number. We can immediately specify the index I. And the second argument is the base. And I use a base 2. Yeah? So 1/2, 1/4, 1/2 plus 1/4, and so on. And let's run this. But I have, of course, I need to update here the title. So this is now uniform from van der Korpus sequence. Yeah, so this is a quasi random number sequence. And I also update here the title of my plot. And let's run this and let's check how this looks like. Okay, so now we have these guys here. Both experiments used the same number of sample paths. Okay, and you see The low discrepancy sequence generates, of course, a very smooth result. Yeah, you have a much better uniformity in the uniform distribution, which gives you a much smoother result in the inverse of the cumulative distribution function. Yeah, okay, very nice method. Okay. Of course, you can repeat this now with Mersenne-Twister and just check how it looks like. I would like to do another part in my code session. So here's my code session on the slide. Yeah. So first task was that we should create the sequence with, say, Java util random or Mersenne-Twister and with a van der Korput sequence and just explore a little bit how the sequence looks like. So that is now done. And the second part is I would like to investigate a little bit the properties of this implementation. So for either limit cases, what happens if UI is zero, or for different implementations. And for example, we could also check here the round trip. So if you take x equals phi inverse of u, and then you take phi of x, it should be the identity. It should be again u. Yeah? And if both has numerical rounding errors, what actually happens with this round trip? Let's test this a little bit. I comment out now here the code that does the block, the plots, sorry. I comment this out and I just have here test normal ICDF implementation and we test maybe the Apache Common Math 3 implementation. So the one which we already had here. So I generate this normal object. And let's first check what happens to certain values. So assume I have here an argument, say that is the uniform one. So which I pass in, for example, I could pass in just 1/2. What happens to this? So let's print a small headline. So testing this implementation. Let's make it a little bit nice. Printing some line. And let's print out the number which we test. Yeah, so this is our number u. So this is the uniform number which we pass in as an argument. So next step I would like to do is to perform the transformation to the normal one. So x is normal inverse cumulative distribution function of the uniform. So let's print out this x. So this is now x of u. No, my inversion. And maybe I can run this. So 1/2 is mapped to 0. Maybe I also do some other test here with 0.2. 0.2 is mapped to minus 0.8. Okay, so let's continue. And I would like to do the round trip. What happens if I now calculate again u from that? So I go here, there is a cumulative distribution function, a cumulative probability. So the distribution function, I would like to calculate that from x. Okay, let's call this now p. Yeah, it's the probability because u is already used here in the printout. So this here is now my P, and this P is actually the U of X, where X has been calculated by U. So the question is this now U? Okay, and we made successfully the round trip. Yeah, if we do U, we do F inverse, and we apply F again, we get once again around. And maybe let's print also the exponential of X, because that is something which is maybe relevant if we do a log normal model. The log normal model is an exponential of a normal distributed random variable, and also maybe exponential of minus x. So let's take also the exponential of minus x, and let's print these two guys. So first one is exponential of x, of x of u. So this is this guy. Now make it a bit nicer. Okay, and also print exponential of minus x of u. So this is this guy. Good, that is correct. So now I have a small test program to test a little bit the values. Let's check what happens if we take one of these boundary points, the zero. Okay, so u equals zero maps to normal distribution x minus infinity. Okay, so I have the normal distribution, it is minus infinity. So u of x of u maps back to zero, exponential maps back to zero, exponential of minus x of u maps to infinity. What happens if I use one? Okay, so for one, I'm mapping to plus infinity. The inverse, the round trip is fulfilled. The round trip is fulfilled. I map back to one. The exponential of u maps to infinity. This guy maps to zero. Well, so if you have a zero here, the last two one go to zero and infinity. So it's just the other way around. What is puzzling me a little bit is I have here this infinity. So if the uniform random number generator generates a zero, which can happen for Java util random for floating point numbers, my inversion will map to minus infinity, and exponential of minus x will map to infinity. This can be an issue. Okay, so why can this be an issue? So consider this little example where I would like to calculate a put option. So I have a put option. So the put option is just the inverse here of the call option, that I have here k minus s. Yeah. And now I consider a Bachelier model. So for the Bachelier model, it is s is not log normal distributed. It is normal distributed, but it would also be a problem if we have a log normal one. Yeah? So here it is just the Bachelier model. Okay, so if u is zero, then s will map to minus infinity. This means that v of t and omega I, so this here is the s of omega I, the v of t and omega I will then map to plus infinity. And then if you look at a Monte Carlo evaluation, you perform here, there isn't one divided by n here missing, you perform here a sum over values that have here a plus infinity inside. And I will get a plus infinity. Yeah. But in Monte Carlo, actually, it should be a very rare event, but sometimes then I get a plus infinity, so it destroys my whole calculation. So while here the round tripping is fine, actually this value can be dangerous. Let's check some other values. What happens, for example, if we take a very small value? For example, 2 to the power of minus 53. Yeah? So that's actually the machine precision. Okay, looks very nice. Yeah, machine precision input. X is minus 8. Yeah? It's a larger number. If I do calculate U again, I get again small number. Exponential is 10 to the minus 4. Looks very reasonable. Very nice. Let's take another value which is also small, the smallest possible, and now you remember computer arithmetic, denormalized numbers. So the smallest non-zero positive value. Okay, here's our double min value. What's that? So you see, this number will map to minus infinity. So he considers it like to be zero. Yeah. And then the round trip is broken. So for this implementation here, the inverse and then the function again is not the input argument. To conclude, let me show you another implementation. So let me just copy here this whole test. And now I call it test normal ICDF implementation. And I will take the implementation which I had on the slide. So now I do that. Let's just maybe copy it so we see both. Let's print out some space between the two. So now I'm testing here Vichura. Implementation. So I can remove that guy. And I just used that for the inverse. Okay, so here I use now a different implementation. So I use here inverse cumulative normal distribution from this paper, which was on the slide. And we can have a look into this implementation. So I just use a different implementation here for the inverse. I deleted this line, but I use, of course, here for the normal distribution, I use the same function from Apache Common Math. So let's take a look at this implementation. So let's create here an argument. So double uniform. This is some 0.5, and I pass it to both tests. So we can have a look at both tests and compare them a little bit. So now I have two different implementations. I enter U uniform 1/2 will map to the center point of the normal distribution. If I map it back using the distribution function, I get again 1/2. Exponential of 0 maps to 1, of minus 0, of course, also to 1. Yeah, the same for the other implementation. Let's take the very small value. 2 to the power of minus 53. Okay, so I get here slightly different result here, yeah, but I get the same result for the round trip. So the round trip works, but the two implementations have a slightly different value here for the inverse. Well, and this guy here claims that he's right up to machine precision. Yeah, so I don't know if this error here is relevant. Yeah, but they look the same. What happens at the limit cases? Let's take zero, our limit case. So what happens at zero, the limit case? Well, that's strange. Yeah. So this guy is actually avoiding, he's actually avoiding the minus infinity, and he's mapping the zero to zero. So that seems unreasonable. So let me go here to my slide. Yeah, on this slide, I have here this little exercise. Compare different implementations of the inverse cumulative distribution functions for some numbers and also these limit cases. And what's happening is that we have here our interval of the uniforms. So I believe I used that color for the uniforms. And here I have the interval for the normal distribution. So 1/2 is mapped here to zero. So here I have somehow the distribution function, the density. And for the Apache common mass, it is that the limit points are actually mapped to minus infinity and plus infinity. And everything in between is, of course, distributed like the normal distribution would do it. Okay, and this other implementation does, well, I believe it does the same. You can do the plot, it does the same, except for the limit points, it maps the two limit points to zero. And do you like it or not? I don't know. For me as a programmer, it's maybe nice because it avoids that minus infinity and plus infinity occur. So he guarantees that the result is a floating point number, which is finite. He guarantees this. So I do not allow him to issue minus infinity and plus infinity. And then which number is the safest that I can return? Well, zero is the most frequent number. Yeah. And if I want to throw something away, I just put it into the zero because there I do the least harm. So while it looks at first that this is here maybe a strange implementation, it's from a numerical method programmer quite reasonable because the implementation will avoid the problematic value plus and minus infinity. And actually, if you do many Monte Carlo experiments, you do not see this issue. Yeah. So zero doesn't come too often just because of this. So actually, I like it. Yeah? I personally like it. And now one last example. Let's take this value, double min value. So the value where Apache Common Math actually failed in the round trip. And a nice thing is that this value is 10 to the minus 324, so very small number. He will generate minus 38. So he generates not minus infinity. And if you then apply Apache Common Math distribution function to this value, you actually get the input value. Okay, so the round trip works. That's a nice implementation. So I really like this implementation here. And maybe we can conclude the session by just looking at the code. So this here is the code. It is from this paper here. And as I mentioned, it is a piecewise rational function. So you have polynomials. There are coefficients for the polynomials. Here, 8 coefficients. 7 coefficients, and then you have a rational function. So this polynomial here divided by this polynomial here. Okay, and then it is a piecewise rational. So there are some if statements, and sometimes you return this guy, sometimes you return this guy, sometimes you return this guy. So it looks a little bit ugly, yeah. So a few coefficients here, but apart from that, it's just a polynomial. It's quite fast. It's a nice implementation. So that was it for this coding session. So to complete, maybe I can enable the plots. And here below, for my two plots, I maybe use now the other implementation. So I do not use this normal one. So here I use this implementation from this paper. Okay, so I replaced that line here. The same for the Java util random. I do not use that one, I use that one. So I use the other implementation of the inverse distribution function. And I just repeat the plotting. So you see that we also get the nice results. So the uniform random number generator is the same, and we perform now the inversion to get the normal distribution. Yeah, that was it for this session, and I hope you liked it. Thank you.